Good morning, scholars. My name is Ms. Thompson, and I teach history at New Tech East High School. Today's lesson is going to be about the protesting that has been going on in Columbus around the stay-at-home order and the closing of businesses. This picture here was taken and published in the Columbus Dispatch on April 18th, and it is a gathering of people outside the Ohio State House to demonstrate the stay-at-home order. My question to you is, do these protesters remember what they learned in their high school history and government classes? At the end of this lesson, you will get to be the judge. When we look back at the history of our government, we have to start with the Enlightenment ideas, and that is taught in world history. In the 1600s and 1700s, we had Enlightenment thinkers that came up with revolutionary ideas. The first is Rousseau. He had the idea of social contract. A social contract is an agreement in which people band together for the common good. When they band together, it's called a sovereign. And the sovereign's interest, or the general will, always promotes the common good. This is in contrast to the private will of each citizen, which strives only for personal benefit. So he said that when people come together in a social contract, they do give up some of their own personal benefit for the good of all. Opposite of his beliefs was Voltaire. He believed in freedom of expression. His idea that personal liberty and freedom of speech are the most important. He believed that people were rational and that for the most part were capable of thinking for themselves, and they did not need the government thinking for them. He did understand that there were some people who were not able to have rational thought, and he wanted them to seek the guidance of religion to help keep them on the straight and narrow. They often quarreled and wrote nasty letters back and forth to each other. The next person is Adam Smith. He had the idea of hands-off economics. He believed that our free market economy, our capitalist economy, was most productive when the government had an invisible hand. That means that this hand would not be visible, it would be invisible, in which they're not controlling the economy and letting it be. This idea of the invisible hand is part of what is today known as the laissez-faire, meaning let do or let go approach to the market. Again, it's where there's a balance between the government and its interventions and the market controlling itself. That's one of the arguments with the economy today. In Natural Rights with John Locke, he believed that we were born as human beings with the rights of life, liberty, and property, and that they could not be taken away from us, and that you could not give them up voluntarily. They are impossible to surrender. He believed that if a sovereign, a king or a ruler, violated these human rights, natural rights, the social contract would be broken and that the people had the right to revolt and establish a new government. These ideas of Locke were used by Thomas Jefferson 100 years later in the writing of the Declaration of Independence. So the Enlightenment ideas influence our founding fathers. The first historic document that you would learn about in U.S. history is the Declaration of Independence. It was written in 1776 by Thomas Jefferson, and it was approved by the Congress on July 4th. And it was a list of grievances or complaints against the king and established our own country. He used these ideas of the social contract to secure the rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. He took the idea of property and changed it to pursuit of happiness. And then there's also that governments are instituted among men, deriving their powers from the consent of the governed. That means that the government is made up of all of its people, and that it gets its power from the people of which it is governing. This was a very revolutionary idea. After our country became a country, we realized that we needed to have a government system in place. And so the first one that they came up with is the Articles of Confederation, which is our second historic document. The Articles of Confederation became a contract between the 13 states, and it established like a league of friendship. It was like 13 people that hung around together, but were not linked together. They could do their own thing. They could be their own way, because the Articles of Confederation gave almost all the power to each state. The central government was not really much at all. It consisted only of a legislature, people who could write laws, but they couldn't write very many laws. This government was established because the colonists wanted to preserve their liberties and their rights that were taken away from them under the authority of King George. But this caused a huge problem without having a central government. They couldn't regulate trade between states. They couldn't keep states from circulating their own currency. So there was New York dollars and Pennsylvania dollars and Massachusetts dollars. There wasn't a US currency that was accepted in all places. There was no chief executive or no leader that could make real decisions. And there was no national court that would settle disputes between the states. They had to fight it out. There was nobody to balance out their disputes. Well, this caused a major problem. And so once the founding fathers identified that there were a ton of weaknesses in the Articles of Confederation, they got together again and they created a new plan. And that plan is the Constitution. The next historic document we're going to discuss is the preamble. The preamble of the Constitution is the very first paragraph. It is like the introduction to what the whole essay is going to be like. It's like what you write in English when you're writing an essay. And the preamble reads as such: "We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution for the United States of America." What's important there is you see that it is a capital U in United and a capital S in states. This was the first time that they recognized that all 13 states were one entity. And that establishes, is explained in the more perfect union. They also wanted to establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, which is peace at home, provide for the common defense, having a military. But the two that we're going to focus on right now is promote the general welfare and secure the blessings of liberty. General welfare is the good of all, the common good. They wanted to make sure that they promoted or made sure that there was the common good. But they also wanted to secure the blessings of liberty. That means they wanted to make sure that they still had those rights and liberties and freedoms that they were so desperate for when they broke away from England. So now we're getting at a crossover between history and government. In U.S. history, you learn a little bit about the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists, and then you go much more deep into it in U.S. government. The Federalists were a group of the Founding Fathers who believed that the Constitution established a strong national government and that it was needed to protect our nation and to solve the problems, that there needed to be a whole government that ruled everything. On the other hand, you have the Anti-Federalists. They did not like the Constitution They wanted to make sure that there were still strong state governments. They were fearful of a strong national government. It hadn't been that many years since they were a part of England, and they were really worried that a strong national government would take away the rights and liberties of our people. So, as always, when you have two groups of people arguing over what they think is right, they're either going to come to a stalemate or they're going to come up with a compromise. The compromise in this situation between the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists is the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights is the first 10 amendments to the Constitution. So they wrote the Constitution, all the articles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Then they had their arguments, the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists, and they wanted this and they wanted that, and they were going back and forth. And so they came up with these first 10 amendments to the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. All of them protect the rights of individuals and the states. In this lesson, there's two amendments that are our focus. First one, Amendment 1. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. What does that mean? Well, what it means is that the government can make no law establishing a religion. So establishing a religion for the country, or making you believe in one religion or be a part of a religion at all. They also cannot prohibit the way that you exercise or go about doing your religion. Going to church, not going to church, going to temple, synagogue, whatever. They can't regulate that. There's also, they cannot curb your freedom of speech. You should have the right to say whatever you want, whenever you want. Or of the press, you are able to write what you want to write, and on the internet, in newspaper, wherever. They also can't keep people from assembling in a peaceable manner. That means the protests. People have the right to come together and protest. And to petition the government for a redress of the grievances means you have the right to tell the government what you don't like. So these are all rights that are being argued all the time right now, because a lot of states are not allowing people to go to church. They're making funerals and weddings 10 people or less. They're saying that they're breaking those rights. If they go to assemble together, that they're not allowed, that they're violating their First Amendment rights by telling them that they can't come together. So then the second amendment we're going to talk about is Amendment number 10. It's the last one of the Bill of Rights, and basically Amendment 10 is the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. Okay, that's confusing. The Constitution, 7 articles, lists all the things that each branch of government can do. Okay? If the power or the right to do something is not listed as a power of the federal government, and it also doesn't say that the states cannot do this, then those things that are not listed are given to the states or to the people. Example of this is education and economics. And this is the amendment that the governor is using with closing schools and shutting down businesses and things like that. So this is one that's being very highly contested. The last part of this is the Supreme Court. Okay, so the Supreme Court, their job is to interpret or to judge the constitutionality of laws. And when this group of 9 people who are appointed for life come together. They are supposed to look at the Constitution and any laws and decide if they are in a line with the Constitution or breaking the Constitution. Problem is that these nine people, they're human beings. They have beliefs, they have biases. And so a lot of times the verdict of the case is based off of those people's biases. And it can change through history. And there are many examples of times when there's been one court case that overturns another court case because the people's ideas have changed. But the one I'm going to talk about here is Schenck versus U.S. in 1919. This one has to do with the First Amendment rights being violated, and it's one that's being used with the protests going on now. So in 1919, Schenck was distributing papers to people saying that the draft, when they draft men to go to war, because this was during World War I, that instituting the draft for these men violated the 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment is the amendment that ended slavery. It's a prohibition against involuntary servitude. In his papers, it said that he was urging the public to disobey the draft. So basically not do the draft, like avoid the draft. But he advised only peaceful action. So he wasn't asking for people to do things that were violent. He was arrested and charged with a violation of the Espionage Act of 1917, which had to do with World War I. His case went to the Supreme Court, and he claimed that his First Amendment rights were violated when he was arrested. After hearing the whole court case, the court said that him being arrested under the Espionage Act, it did not violate his First Amendment rights because it was Congress's right during wartime to limit the First Amendment freedom of speech. This is the first time that the clear and present danger test was mentioned. So basically the clear and present danger test says that if an action happens and the First Amendment is not protected, when that speech approaches creating a clear and present danger of the significant evil that Congress has power to prevent. So if your speech can hurt other people, then it would be under the clear and present danger clause, and it would not, your First Amendment rights could be controlled. You could actually be in trouble for saying things like fire in a crowded movie theater. Because you're going back to that idea of social contract where you have to look at the common good. Okay, so that was a lot of stuff. And so as we end this lesson, I want you to think about a few things. I'm going back to this first picture. Do these protesters have the right to assemble? Answer that question for yourself. And looking at their signs, do their arguments promote the general welfare? Look at the stuff that we have gone over today with world history, U.S. history, U.S. government, your Enlightenment ideas, your historic documents, the preamble, the Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights, the First Amendment, and the 10th Amendment. Are these arguments promoting the general welfare? That's the end of my lesson. And what I have to leave you with is this. Now it's your time. You be the judge. Remember your history. Be safe. And remember, all of your teachers miss you. And we hope you're doing well.
This is CMSD.
I am.
I am.
I am.
Yo.
soy.
I am
Cleveland's Public Schools.
Good morning. My name is Rebecca Ward, and I'm an English teacher at Facing History New Tech High School. So today I want to use our English time as an opportunity to shout out to all of our Cleveland AP students taking an AP exam in all kinds of subject areas this week and next week. So in case you didn't know or you needed to hear it today, we are so proud of you. You are amazing. You took a chance. Not just on taking an AP class and taking like a more rigorous course, you took a chance on yourself and you gave yourself an opportunity to be pushed past some of your academic boundaries. You're ready to take on a higher level task. You are phenomenal. And it is impossible to express in words just how awed we are by your choices this year. You have done such a great job. So just in case you have forgotten, here are some of the benefits to taking an AP class, just in case you're thinking about taking one or you just needed a reminder. Remember, when you take an AP class, there's always a GPA boost. But more importantly, you learn some essential time management skills when you take an AP class because you have an increase in coursework, an increase in studying, an increase in homework, and it teaches you those time management skills you're going to need once you hit college and career. And finally, we do know that students who take an AP class are more likely to succeed at a four-year institution. And I'm not talking about who take a class and score a 4 or 5. No, I'm talking about anyone who just takes the course. Just taking the course, no matter what you score on the test, means that you are more likely to succeed at a four-year institution. So, because we have this special English time, we're actually going to spend some time talking about the English language and composition exam, because that is the one that I teach and I'm very excited about it, and I'm very excited about my students taking it, but also because it's one of the most commonly taken AP courses in the district. So if you are taking the AP language and composition test, it is May 20th at 2 p.m. Okay, that is a Wednesday. You want to log on about 30 minutes prior to the exam. So we want to make sure that you go ahead and log in at 1:30 p.m. And then you are going to have 45 glorious minutes to read and annotate and write your essay. You get those 45 full minutes. So from start to finish, you're going to read your text, annotate it, take some notes, and write your essay. And then you'll have 5 additional minutes to upload your response. All right. So we are going to take a look at rhetoric, which is the task that we're being asked to do on the AP Lang exam. And it's something that even if you never aspire to take AP English Language and Composition, though secretly, I really hope that you do, right? Rhetoric is something that everyone needs to know about because rhetoric is everywhere. It's in the commercials that you watch. It's in the articles that you read in the New York Times or the Washington Post. It's in the conversation that you have across the dinner table with one of your relatives. It's in the texting argument that you have with your friends about where to go to dinner. Rhetoric is literally everywhere. So what is rhetoric, right? What is rhetoric and why do we care about it? So rhetoric is the art of effective persuasion in speaking or writing. Right? So when we talk about rhetoric, we're talking about using the tools that are available to us in a given situation to persuade. And we also talk a lot about what's called the rhetorical triangle. The rhetorical triangle is made up of the speaker. So that's the person or the group that creates the text. So you might have a speech, or you might have a piece of artwork, or you might have an essay. All of these things are created by a speaker or a writer. That's the person or group who creates the text. Then you have the audience. That's the listener, the reader, the viewer of the text, right? And when we talk about audience, there's two different types of audiences. There's the primary audience, so the person that the speaker or writer is directly gearing their text towards. And then you also have the secondary audience, which is anybody who might come in contact with that text. And finally, you have the subject, which is not the purpose, just in general, the subject of the text. So when the three of these things work together, you have the creation of this text through what we call rhetoric. So the choices that an author or a speaker is making in an attempt to persuade an audience about a particular subject, right? So when we do a rhetorical analysis, we are trying to take apart the choices that a speaker makes in order to persuade their audience. So what tools, what strategies might a speaker or a writer use in order to persuade? Now, when I was in high school, this meant memorizing a long list of these things we call rhetorical devices, and we would have to prove how a writer used the cynic note to paradoxic the metonym or something. Anyway, the point is, we've moved away from all that. It's no longer this lengthy list of vocabulary words that you will never, ever, ever use again. And I feel completely safe saying that. I've never used those words since I took the class. But rather, we now analyze more meaningfully what the choices are a writer might use. What tools do they use to persuade a particular audience? So when we look at all of the circumstances, the factors, the influences, and the tools that are surrounding a particular text, so what is happening in this text, and we break it apart to try to describe how those things work together to create a certain effect or to persuade an audience of a certain thing. All right, so when we talk about strategies, there are a couple of things that we might talk about, and you can talk about these things in very plain English. So you have the ideas that are being communicated in the speech or the text, the appeals that the speaker or the writer might use. And yes, when we talk about appeals, we are talking about the ethos, pathos, and logos of a text, but we're not probably going to use those words. We might talk about how a writer appeals to the sentimentality of an issue, right? Or how a writer uses logic to convince the audience of a certain thing, right? We also want to look at the tone, right? So the speaker's attitude towards the topic, what is that? What tone does the speaker have when they are constructing this text? What's the structure of the text? How is it organized? What details does the writer choose to use? And do they use a particular method of development, or do they use a range of methods of development? Maybe they compare and contrast. They could use description, narration. Maybe they tell a story to convince, or maybe they have that cause and effect set up, right? So what types of strategies are they using in order to convince the reader? So once you've identified what the tools are that the writer or speaker is using, you need to determine how those tools are effective in a given rhetorical situation. So why these tools for this speaker to this audience at that time? And I like to put all of this together using a handy dandy little acronym we English teachers call Space Cat. Now, your teacher might call it something different. They might have the four questions. I like Space Cat because it's got a cat in it, but also because it kind of covers all of the things that you need to have to take apart the rhetorical situation when you're approaching a passage. So let's take a look at Space Cat and what it means. So Space Cat stands for all of the things in a rhetorical analysis that you need to have, that you need to look at. So first you have S, the speaker, right? Who is writing or creating the text? What's their purpose? What are they trying to argue? Who is the intended audience? And here we're going to think about primary, but you might also think about secondary audiences. In different passages and different texts, you might have both a primary audience, but also a secondary audience. It is very important. What's the context of the text? So what are the social forces? What's happening around the creation of the text that we could draw on that's really important that we might want to include that will inform our analysis, inform our reading of that text? What can we bring to bear on that text? What's the exigence? And exigence is a really cool word that I'm sure you have played with a lot this year. But exigence basically means, why exactly is this text being created right now? Like, why right now, right? What is causing this text to be written right now? And then you get to the cat part of Space Cat. So what are the choices being made? So what different choices does the speaker or the writer make in their text? What appeals do they use? That gets us back to that ethos, pathos, and logos, right? So what are they trying to develop a sense of authority on a particular issue? Are they appealing to sentimentality for something? Do they use logic to convince the reader? What different appeals are they using? And finally, what's the tone of the text, right? So how does the speaker feel about, or what attitude do they have towards their argument or towards the topic of the text? You want to be able to identify that tone. All right. So we do not obviously have time to take apart an entire passage in our segment today, but what I did want to do was try to work through a prompt, and just by using the prompt, see what we can discover and how much of a thesis we could devise for our rhetorical analysis just by looking at the prompt, not by looking at anything else. Okay, so we're just going to look at the prompt. So this is the prompt, and this prompt was taken apart and analyzed really heavily by the College Board lessons that came out when we sort of just went into the COVID closure. It was in the first week's worth of lessons when they were covering units 8 and 9. And if you haven't taken a look at those, I really highly recommend that you spend some time with those videos because they are so good and they go really in depth. So if you have access to YouTube and you can get on there and take a look at those videos, spend some time with them. They're really quality and the teacher just does an amazing job of digging into this passage and helping you dig into it too. Again, we're just going to look at the prompt. That's all we're looking at today. So here's the prompt. In the following letter, Abigail Adams writes to her son, John Quincy Adams, who is traveling abroad with his father, John Adams, a United States diplomat and later the country's second president. Read the letter carefully. Write an essay that analyzes the rhetorical choices Adams makes to convey her argument about the value of experience. Well, I'm going to make an argument here, and the argument that I'm going to make here is to actually spend a lot of time with the prompt, because the prompt gives you a lot of information. And what I want to caution you of when you are spending time with the prompt is I want you to avoid Googling anything. I know there is this like tendency that we have. As soon as we get a topic, we want to sit down and say, okay, how can I Google this? What can I figure out? What can I do? But you don't want to do that. I am telling you right now that everything that you need to be successful on this task is in your head and in the passage. You have everything that you need, and you don't need to worry or waste any time Googling something. Believe me, if the College Board thought that you could get the answer by Googling it, they would not still be in business, right? They would not be providing you with that prompt. So don't Google it. I want you to use just what's in your head, what you've learned this year, what you know, because generally we all have moms or parental figures in our lives who try to convince us of things, right? If we have somebody in our life who's going to try to convince us, whether it's a teacher or a parent or an older sibling. And then we also have, you know, at times when somebody's tried to convince us of something. So you can do this easily on your own, okay? You don't need anything from the outside. So how can we space cat this? How can we do that? How do we space cat this? How do we make this into a rhetorical analysis? So before we look at the passage, before we look at anything else, we're just taking a look at the passage. Here's what we can do with space cat. Speaker, we know it's Abigail Adams, right? What's her purpose? We're going to have to develop that a little bit more once we get into the passage, but we know she's trying to make an argument about the value of experience. And so I put that in purpose because it's going to help guide our reading. As we read the passage, we can try to figure out, okay, what is she trying to say about the value of experience? Who is her audience, We know that it's John Quincy Adams. That is her primary audience. She's writing a private letter to her son. We're a secondary audience, right? We weren't really meant to read this letter, right? But her primary audience is John Quincy Adams. So he is the person that we're going to be thinking about. How is he understanding this passage? How is he understanding this letter from his mom? The context is the diplomatic trip abroad, right? But you could also think about context in a lot of other different ways, right? We do know that John Adams is going to be the second president. It says that in the prompt. We also know that Abigail Adams is his wife. That tells us it's early America. So we know the Revolutionary War has just happened. So there's a lot of context there that we could think about the social forces that are happening, right? America's a building country. Those are things that we could bring to bear on this text as well in the context if we wanted to. Okay. And finally, the exigence. So why this letter? Why this text right now? And right now, all we know is that it's her son's trip abroad. We could develop our understanding of the exigence as we read the actual passage. Now, choices, appeals, and tone also will develop our understanding of those as we read the actual passage. So then what can we do with that? Well, we need to start, any good essay starts with a thesis statement. And I also want to give you kind of a frame for how your thesis statement could look. And you can start a draft of that just with what we got from the prompt. So this thesis statement frame comes from a website called The Garden of English. And one of the things that I've learned teaching AP this year is that there are lots of different sources for the course online. You can get a lot of good information from people who've already taken the course, from people who teach the course. So this is one of the things that I've taken from that website, and that website has some really good information on it as you're preparing for the test if you want to check it out. So this gives you a frame that you can have with you, because the test is open book this year, to kind of fill in and figure out how you want your thesis to go. So let's look at what we could already fill in here. We know the genre obviously is a letter. It doesn't have a title, but we know that it's a letter to her son, right? Contextual information about the author. We know that Jane Addams is the wife of John Adams. She's the eventual second first lady. Her name is Abigail Adams. We can't get into rhetorical choices just yet, but we do have quite a bit. So this is what it might look like, right? In a letter to her son, John Quincy Adams, mother and eventual first lady, Abigail Adams, and then we move on with the parts we can't fill in yet because we haven't dug into the passage. So now you're ready to do that, right? Now you're ready to dig into the passage. And I hope that I have gotten you interested in this text by Abigail Adams, this letter to her son, and that you are ready to just dig in and start to think about, okay, so how is she going to persuade her son about the value of experience? And what exactly does she want him to think? So I really would encourage you to take a look at the rest of this passage and think about what's being said here, and what are the tools that she is bringing to bear on this text. Now, you also use rhetoric in your everyday life. So if you don't dig into Abigail Adams, I would still encourage you to think about how the rhetorical situation, right, the interaction between the speaker, the audience, and the subject create text, and how people might try to convince you of certain things and what tools they might be using to convince. Now, no matter who you are and whether or not you are taking an AP test this week, I encourage you to take care of yourself and know that if you are a Cleveland student, we are so proud of you and your continued efforts to learn during this crisis. We think you are the bee's knees. You are amazing. We love you so much and we can't wait to see you again when it is safe. Thanks so much. And if you're taking an AP test, good luck. We know you're going to do great.
I was born and raised in Cleveland, Ohio.
I'm in the Fulton, Memphis area.
My wife and I and our three boys live in Edgewater.
I live in the Lakeshore, Collinwood Arts District.
I live in Camps Corner area.
I've lived in the West Park neighborhood for 21 years.
For 5 years.
I've lived in Cleveland all my life.
37 years.
Majority of my life.
All my life.
18 years.
Cleveland's great. I mean, I love that there's always stuff to do. There's so many free things to do with kids.
Best city in the country. I love it. I mean, it's a good city. The school system is awesome.
I think Cleveland schools are making great progress.
new things are happening in CMSD, you know, I want to be a part of that.
So the Cleveland Plan was legislation that was put in place in 2012 to be able to transform Cleveland's public schools.
The change in the school district in the last, you know, 10 years is one that's focused on high performance, that's focused on providing school choice for families so they can figure out what school is best for them, and moving into a period where we're acknowledging that education needs need to change for our students, for our economy, for our families, and how do we meet families where they are to do that?
The schools offer far more choices. They're more career-oriented.
All kids don't learn the same. All kids aren't interested in the same things. I like the fact that we do have those choices.
If your child needs a particular approach or needs in the kind of classroom to help meet their growth, I think the Cleveland Plan is about providing those options too.
I've just been really happy with the preschool here. I'm just so grateful that I found this school and that my child is here.
It's nice. It's very nice to know I can choose what school. I can have my options of going to each building and seeing what is the best choice for my kids.
When I did research, I was looking for the best schools that Cleveland had to offer.
The teachers are great. They work well with us. They constantly keep in communication with us, and that's really the key, is like that we're all involved.
It's nice to walk into a school and have them know who you are.
The structure of the academics is very, very rigorous, and I love it.
I am a 2016 graduate of Cleveland Early College High School on the John Hay campus. Choice for me was great because I had the opportunity to really take ownership of my education.
The high school graduation push and the increase is definitely a result of what the district is doing in order for the schools to thrive, because now you have better schools, quality schools, and when you can push that, students see that you care about them. Now they begin to care about their education.
We stand with 117 private colleges that are going to offer every student in the public school system of Cleveland, Ohio, free college tuition.
Say Yes to Education is an initiative in our city which offers wraparound support services to students and their families so that students can be most successful in their K-12 education. Probably the biggest headline of Say Yes is that it's going to offer last dollar tuition scholarships to students to any public 2 or 4 year institution, as well as accredited Pell eligible career and technical trainings.
Families at this point have no choice to say that, oh, my child, I can't afford college, or I'm not going to send my child to college, because that opportunity is there.
The barriers, the social, economic, demographic, all of the things that especially a lot of urban kids have to endure, which prevents a lot of them from prospering, are definitely minimized.
It's amazing. I couldn't be happier with the way Cleveland is moving up.
We are doing what we set out to do in 2012 with the Cleveland Plan. We are actually seeing results, and that's a great thing. It's an incredible accomplishment. We don't see this kind of growth in an urban district elsewhere in this country.
The children are the future. Anything that we do, we have to plan for them to get a great education, a quality education that is technologically advanced, so that they're prepared. And with that preparation, you can't stop us. Cannot stop us. So look out every other city, because Cleveland is on their way.
This is CMSD.
I am Cleveland Public Schools.
Buenos dias, good morning. My name is Señora Olivera. I'm a Spanish teacher at Cleveland High School in architecture and design at John Hay campus. And this is my lesson. Vamos a aprender palabras connadas. Connada means that the root of the word is similar or the same to the foreign word. In this case, it's going to be Español, Inglés, Formación y Vocabulario. Connadas, Español, Inglés, Información, Vocabulario. coronavirus. As you see, coronavirus is spelled exactly the same. The difference is the pronunciation. Pandemia, coronavirus, pandemia. Doctor trabajando. Do you recognize any word in there? Yeah, you guessed that right. Doctor. Casos, leves y moderados. Graves, críticos. Casos, moderados. Leves y moderados, 80%. Por ciento. Graves, 14%. Por ciento. Críticos, 6%. Por ciento. You heard me say the word por ciento. Por ciento. Por ciento. When you are learning a foreign language, repetition is very important. Now, if you look in this sentence, it says 100% completo. Do you recognize that word? It's almost the same. Yes, you do. Casos leves y moderados. Dolor de cabeza, estornudos, dolor de garganta, tos y dolor muscular. Although this page is full of words, only few are similar. Moderados, muscular. Leve, recuperación rápida. Recuperación. Casos graves. Oxígeno suplementario. Now, can you see oxígeno suplementario? Did you see how I crossed the pointer? Because oxígeno is the noun, el suplementario is the adjective. And in Spanish, you write first the noun and then the adjective, except with numbers and quantity. Casos críticos, like coronavirus, hospital is spelled exactly the same. The pronunciation is different. En casos moderados, graves y críticos, se puede contraer, neumonía, neumonía. Look at this sentence, 5 días después de contraer el virus. Do you recognize any word in there? I'm sure you do. Look, días, contraer, virus. Comienzan los síntomas. Síntomas. Algunas personas, before they know that they have the virus, they have náuseas, vómitos, dolor abdominal y diarrea. Náuseas, vómitos, abdominal, diarrea. COVID-19 es una enfermedad respiratoria. Respiratoria. Ataca. Ataca comes from the verb atacar and in an AR in Spanish. And I'm sure that you are going to make a connection. Look, atacar. Ataca. You see? El sistema respiratorio. Again, look, sistema respiratorio. Daña. Pay attention to that word. Daña. Daña has a ñ. It's not an N. It's a ñ. It's an extra letter the Spanish alphabet has. Daña. It's a strong N. Los hilos y los pelos. Remember the word that I say that you have to remember? Do you remember? Yes. Daña. Daña las células, los pulmones, los bronquios y la tráquea. Produce, tos seca, producir. Do you recognize that verb? Producir, produce tos seca. Produce falta de respiración. Producir, produce. Síntomas. Temperatura, fiebre, usar. Usar is the verb, it's a verb ending in AR in Spanish. Usar termómetro. What do you think usar mean? Yeah, to use. Síntomas, temperatura, fiebre, termómetro. They are very similar, even the verb usar. Otros síntomas, dolor de garganta, dolor de pecho, dolor de cabeza, fatiga, dolor articulares, y resfrío. This page is full of words, but not many of them are similar, only few. Otros, síntomas y fatiga. What do you see in this picture? Yeah, an examen. Examen. Pacientes recuperados. And again, look, pacientes recuperados. Pacientes contagiosos. Paciente recuperado. Paciente contagioso. Paciente contagioso. El doctor es el único que puede decir cuando el paciente es sin riesgo. Sin mean without. Con mean with. Remember, sin, without. Doctor, paciente, riesgo. Vacuna. Look how similar they are. Transmisión. Estornudos, tos, and the verb tocar, again, ending in AR, tocar. So similar to touch, touching. Transmisión, transmisión, tocar. Prevención, cubrirse is a IR verb, and it's a reflexive one. Cubrir is very similar to the English language, cubrirse. To cover la nariz, la boca, las manos. Now, in this picture, if you look those words, you probably do not recognize any of them. But if you pay attention to the action of that picture, you might guess what they are. Lavarse is a AR verb, and it's reflexive as well, and it means to wash. What are we washing? Las manos. ¿Con qué? Con agua y jabón. Sin agua y sin jabón. Remember what I said the sin mean? Sin agua y sin jabón. Yeah, without water and without soap, we need alcohol gel. Barbijo. Guantes. A una distancia de 6 pies, por favor. The word por favor is very nice to know. Por favor mean please. Distancia. Now, if you look at this picture, you probably might not know what it says under, but if you look the picture in this little house here, you will know the quedarse en casa mean stay home. Un agradecimiento muy especial a los doctores, científicos, enfermeros y personas de primeros auxilios. Especial, doctor y científicos. Now, you probably saw in my slide that my background were green. That's why I put color verde, representa esperanza. Color representa esperanza. Hope. Hope that you are healthy, that you are safe, and that I can see you soon. Hasta pronto. Adiós.
Thank you. Hello, my viewer family, and to my Gators. Stay home, stay safe, take care of your families and each other. I miss you. See you soon.
Hola, esta es la señora Martínez. Saludo a mi clase de primer grado para dejarles saber que los extraño mucho. Los quiero y espero verles pronto. Adiós.
Hi, viewer students. We miss you and we hope that you're staying safe and healthy.
We can't wait to see you soon. We miss you, everyone, and we hope that everyone is staying healthy and connected to their friends and family. See you guys soon.
Hi guys, just to say hi, be careful, take care. I hope to see you soon. Love you all, okay?
Hi everybody, it's Mrs. Dixon, the occupational therapist. Missing everybody. Hope you're doing well. Get outside, enjoy the good weather. Hope you're getting some reading done and some writing. And play a game. And hopefully you can get outside and run around a little bit. Have an Easter egg hunt in your backyard, even if you make Easter eggs out of colored paper. All right. Peace and love.